So in the first code lab of this learning path, you'll be discovering how to create your very own website that's capable of detecting comment spam live in the web browser using pre-made TensorFlow.js machine learning models. Specifically, we'll be using a model that uses the average word embedding implementation. But what exactly is that, and why did we decide to use it over the many other models that are also available? Let's dive into this deeper to learn more. So there are many pre-made models available natively in TensorFlow.js that are easy to use in just a few lines of code. But today, we'll be considering models that are available from TensorFlow's model maker to learn how to take exported saved models from this system and use them in TensorFlow.js, writing all the code to interface with the model directly ourselves. Learning to work at the tensor level like this will put you in good form for using any model you might encounter in the future. So let's take a look at the models available for text classification. Looking at the model maker documentation, we find three text-based models. The key thing to note here is that all of the model architectures shown essentially do the same job. It's just that some are more accurate or versatile than others. In fact, all of these can be used for comment spam detection. As web engineers, size is a big concern to us. For that reason alone, we can disregard the BERT-based model as it's simply too large for us to deploy to the client side. Though it should be noted, if you are running in Node.js on the server side, then of course it'd be possible to use this there. So that leaves us with two options. One is under 1 megabyte in size, which would be very acceptable for mobile and desktop, and the other is 25 to 100 megabytes in size, depending on this thing called quantization. If you go back to your high school days, you may remember that computers have different ways to represent numbers depending on the range of numbers that you want to store, as shown in this table. Clearly, the more memory you use to represent a number, the larger the range of numbers you can store, but it comes with a memory cost. When building and training a machine learning model, it's very common that the 32-bit float type is used to store model weights that allow it to classify the data correctly. However, it turns out that even if you reduce the precision to an 8-bit integer for the weights, the model does not lose too much accuracy. So quantization simply means reducing the precision of the numbers stored in the model to make the resulting file size of the model smaller, and therefore it downloads faster, which is a great thing for the web world. In the chart, you can see how an unsigned 32-bit floating point number is transformed to a single 8-bit integer. Note that often only a very small part of the floating point space is actually used, as shown in this diagram. So we can simply find the bounds of that range and transform it to the full 8-bit space to retain as much detail as possible. Now, the number that previously took 32 bits of memory takes up just 8 bits of memory, which is 4 times less storage space. For the web page we're going to create today, we want it to run as fast and on as many devices as possible, so the 1 megabyte average word embedding model is the one that we will use. We can always switch to the larger quantized model later if desired. Now we've selected a model to use, the next step is to figure out how to pass data into it. As you may know, machine learning models essentially work by processing numbers, numbers in, numbers out, typically floating point numbers to be precise. But if we want to learn information about words, which are a string of characters, how can these words be represented as numbers such that those are alike for a given measure have a similar numerical representation? Let's think about a few ways to do this to learn how our pre-made model is working behind the scenes. Okay, so let's start with the word car. We would simply assign it a number based on its literal order in the English dictionary. However, whilst this will show that the word's characters are similar to another word, for example cat, which would be numerically close, that's not useful to us as we want the meaning to be similar, not the character order. So how can we encode words to give us a numerical way to separate them for any given classification problem? Well, another option would be to have our own dictionary of, say, 1,000 words that we want to be able to compare and give them a score for a dimension of interest. For example, if we had a measure of how medical a word was, doctor would score very high, maybe 0.95, versus pilot, which would score lower on this particular dimension, maybe minus 0.4, using the scale on this slide. Now, one dimension is probably not enough to be useful for classification, so you may need several dimensions to allow you to then organize the words in a way that might be more suitable for what you need to do. As a simple illustration of this, let's say we discovered two meaningful dimensions that measured how medical a word was and also how biological the word was too. We could now draw a 2D graph to represent this, and any given word would lie somewhere on this chart. So for each word in our custom dictionary, we would have a two-dimensional vector to indicate where it lies on each of these dimensions, which we can then use to represent the word to train our model. In the case of the word tumor, you may have a vector of 3, 3, which you could plot on a 2D graph as shown to see where the point would lie. Likewise, the word x-ray, whilst also related to medical things, is not biological, so it might get a score of 2, -3. And here are some other word vectors for comparison. You can think of a vector as an array of numbers where the array length indicates how many dimensions you're working with, and the value of a number indicates where it is on the scale of that dimension. It turns out computers can work with any number of dimensions, like 200 for example. Whilst this is hard for humans to visualize, as we live in a three-dimensional world, the principle is the same as this 2D visualization on this slide. In fact, when training a machine learning model like this, you can specify how many dimensions you want it to try and utilize for separating the words in your dictionary. It will then go ahead and find the most meaningful ways to separate the training data, leading to the best classification results for the task desired. There's actually a rule of thumb determined from research that the fourth root of the number of words works well here. So if I'm using 2,000 words in my dictionary, a good starting point for this would be 7 dimensions to give us enough ways to separate the words for future classification. So if we had a sentence like free software and compared the resulting word vectors with a new sentence like cheap download, here free and cheap might have a similar vector encoding, and software might have a similar encoding to download. If we add the vectors for each given sentence, the overall vector representing each sentence ends up being roughly in the same location if we plotted it on a 7-dimensional graph as shown by the totals on the right. Now we have a way to represent similar sentences with similar vectors. We can use those vector representations of sentences to train a custom machine learning model to then classify a sentence to be spam or not. And here is the end result, visualizing the pre-made spam classifier that you'll use today. It also uses 7 dimensions to function, but we've mapped these 7 dimensions to a 3D visualization to help us explore the word's relations when interpreted for spam. We can see from this visualization how clusters of words that have high correlations of spam versus not spam end up living in different physical spaces as shown. And with that, it's time to get coding yourself and put this all into action. Head on to the first code lab to create a website that can classify spam comments entirely in the web browser.